Good afternoon. You are on to NTA Nationwide. My name is Femi Johnson. Thanks for joining us. A federal high court sitting in Abuja has adjourned the case pressing criminal charges against Colonel Sambo Dasuki, the immediate past National Security Advisor. This is sequel to the court's ruling dismissing the two applications, hampering adjudication on the matter. Dele Atunbi reports.
The first application was a stay of prosecution order brought before the court by the counsel to the accused on the premise of contempt by the prosecution. In his ruling, Justice Adeniyi Ademola dismissed the application based on procedural error and in the interest of justice. Justice Ademola also dismissed the second application, asking the court to allow the 11 prosecution witnesses to be masked while giving evidence in the case. The issue of the accused, Colonel Sambo Dasuki, having access to his counsel and family members, was also brought before the court. Justice Ademola ruled that the accused should be given access to four of his counsels and two family members in the place of his detention and within the court premises.
Court dismissed the application that they should be discharged. And the court also dismissed the application that the witnesses should be hooded.
The application to her to mask their witnesses was turned down.
With these rulings, all is now set for the expeditious airing of the case on the adjourned date. In Abuja, Dele Atunbi, NTA News.
President Muhammadu Buhari's visit to China has been described variously as targeted at the key priority performance of the administration that includes security, power, agriculture, anti-corruption and infrastructural development. During the five-day visit, high-power delegations from Nigeria and China were led by two leaders to discuss issues of common interest, bordering on science and technology, research and development, self-sufficiency in food production and arms production. Apart from the old agreements between Nigeria and China, six new agreements and memorandum of understandings were also signed towards boosting trade, economic, scientific and technological cooperation between the two countries. The program, President Buhari's visit to China, will be on the network service of the Nigerian Television Authority between 8 to 9 tonight. And to National Assembly matters, the Senate has made resolutions urging the Federal Road Safety Commission and the vehicle inspection officers to conduct quick check on all tires in use in Nigeria. Mohammed Ali is standing by with highlights of the Senate's plenary today.
Thank you very much, studio. The Senate this Tuesday afternoon passed for second reading a bill for an act to establish the Federal University of Petroleum Resources, FURU, and then stood down two other bills before inviting other senators who had motions to move. But I have with me here distinguished Senator Obioma Agege, who sponsored the bill on the establishment of the Federal University of Resources, FURU. Distinguished Senator, sir, this university has been in existence. Does it mean that it does not have any role establishing it?
You're very, very correct. Actually, it was established in 2006. It's been functional ever since. We've had four different sets of graduates and two other ones in sciences and engineering, respectively. But unfortunately, for one reason or the other, the enabling legal framework had not been provided. We're not able to fathom the reason why that is the case, but in light of what transpired recently, when the Maritime University at Okorekonko in Warri southwest of Delta State, you know what transpired recently, when the federal government acting through the Minister of not the Minister of Education, the Minister of Transport, under whose ministry the university is domiciled, came out to say that the federal government will no longer proceed without a university. And that's a university that's already was already functional. So our fear, the fear of the stakeholders in Delta State, is that if the federal government could do this with the Okereke, they can also wake up one day and say that the Federal University of Science of Fupre in Wari is abrogated.
Okay, now that it has passed a second reading, yes, it means we are on course.
Oh, very much, very much, very much on course. Now it will go to committee, chaired by, I believe, Senator Binta Masi Garba. She's a very, very good supporter of this institution. We expect that in the next 2-3 weeks, you know, it should clear her committee and report back to the Senate.
Thank you.
And we'll pursue the same in the House of Reps and get it from Mr. President for a signature.
Thank you.
This is not a controversial bill at all. This university is already functional. We just need the legal framework to be put in place.
Thank you very much, sir. The Senate in session also adopted a motion on the use of second-hand tires and of standard tires in the country, moved by Senator Shehu Saini. It also adopted a motion on the reorganization and repositioning of NIPOST for optimal performance. That's a summary of what transpired on the floor of the Senate this Tuesday. Thank you, and over to you in the studio.
Thank you, Mohammed. We move to the House of Representatives, where the Speaker, House of Representatives, Yakubu Dogara, also says the legislature will continue to work towards providing proper solution to the increased rate of poverty and unemployment in the country. It was in his message at the public hearing by the House Committee on Labour, Employment and Productivity. National Assembly correspondent Abdullahi Aminu reports.
The public hearing is aimed at providing adequate measures towards addressing the unemployment rate in the country, especially among the youth. Stakeholders deliberated on the issue, which has compounded the purchasing power of people, leading to increase in social vices, among other effects.
If our teeming youth are gainfully employed, they will channel their energies and talent into mainstream society, which Nigerians can harness in her drive toward industrialization and overall development.
This public hearing also seeks to ascertain the level of compliance of various ministries, departments and agencies.
The public hearing has in attendance representatives of the Federal Character Commission, Civil Service Commission, National Bureau for Statistics and National Productivity Center, among other stakeholders.
All public employment officials, that money should no longer be charged for employment.
The public hearing followed two resolutions of the House which seek for a state of emergency and legislative intervention in the country's employment procedure. From the National Assembly, Abdullahi Aminu, NTA News.
We're still on legislative matters, as the current arguments over deletions and additions to the 2016 budget on the part of the National Assembly and the delayed presidential asset have raised many questions over who has the power of appropriation in Nigeria. This was the cross of discussion today on NTA's program, Good Morning Nigeria. Abdul Malik Adio monitored the discussion.
As controversy continues to thrill the removal of some key projects, including the Lagos-Calabar Rail project and the inclusion of constituency project in the 2016 appropriation bill, guest on Good Morning Nigeria emphatically stressed that the power of appropriation is vested in the legislature, while the implementation lies with the executive.
Lagos, section 8081, you know, what the president lays before the National Assembly are estimates, not budget. It is the responsibility of the National Assembly to pass those estimates. It's after they pass these estimates that they become a budget after it's assented to.
This idea of a railway project from Lagos to Calabar in the first place was not in the first budget, was not in the amended version. And since this thing didn't come from the National Assembly, it came from the presidency, let the presidency or the executive publish it in national dailies that, look, this is where the thing is. It is not with us. It is my words against your word. But nobody is able to dispute that.
If government policy were discussed before the budget was brought and members are put into know of what is in the budget and what the budget represents in their various constituencies, these issues of pardon frost from the executive and introduction of project by various members or in the budget will arise.
So let us not unduly condemn our legislators, but let us also be careful to ensure that they do not use the power they have in an abusive manner. Whether it is constitutional for them to bring in totally new heads, different in character from what was brought forth by the executive, that, in my respectful submission, will be going beyond.
Transparency and value for money in public finance management. In Abuja, Salihu Abdullahi, NTA News.
And science matters now. The Minister of Science and Technology, Dr. Ogbonnaya Onu, has reiterated the commitment of the federal government to fully employ science and technology to diversify the economy. He gave the assurance while receiving the Argentine ambassador to Nigeria on briefings to involve Nigeria in a South-South cooperation project. Justin Ben Unye reports.
Lead national expert for Component 1 on technical regulation of the UNEDU, Abimbola Rozoma, led members of the working group on advocacy visit to the ministry. She disclosed that UNEDU is running a program sponsored by the European Union to the tune of 12 million euros, a program that aims at addressing the quality of infrastructure in Nigeria. She attributed the rejection of some Nigerian exports in the international community to the poor quality of infrastructure and packaging. The Minister of Science and Technology maintained that the country is already on the path of ensuring all infrastructure meets basic minimum international standards.
We want to see our economy strong, and we want to see our developmental efforts to be sustainable. And in order to achieve that, our infrastructure must be well developed, and our infrastructure must also meet the basic minimum standards.
The team has concluded the drafting of the policy and has gone round the 6 geopolitical zones of the country to validate the policy. Justin Bem Unyi, NTA News.
The National Judicial Council has recommended the compulsory retirement of Justice Ogbaje Abiamila of Lagos State High Court and Justice Idris Evu of the Niger State High Court with immediate effect. This is in a statement by the Acting Director Information of the Council. It explains at its meeting under the chairmanship of the Chief Justice of the Federation, Justice Mahmoud Mohammed. The Council recommended for Justice Gbaje Abiamila pursuant to the findings by the Council on the allegations contained in the petitions written against him, while Justice Evu was also recommended for retirement after a fact-finding committee by the Council found from the record that he falsified his birth records. Meanwhile, the Council has, however, exonerated Justice Sally Susedu of the Federal High Court, Lagos, as is found unsubstantiated petition of alleged misconduct written against him. And for more on legal issues, let's join Abdullahi as he takes us through the stories that will be coming from our Lagos Network Center. It's over to you, and good to see you.
Good to see you too, Femi, and thanks for joining us here in Lagos. African leaders have been enjoined to embrace the International Criminal Court ICC as a veritable agent for the development of the continent and should not hold the court in suspicion. A presiding judge of the court, Chile Ebwe Osuji, said this when he delivered the 2016 Founders Day lecture of the Nigerian Institute of Advanced Legal Studies. Vera Chumba was there.
Justice Chile Ebwe Osuji, who spoke on the value of International Criminal Court ICC to Africa, said the court was established to foster economic growth, curb conflict and atrocities, as well as put an end to impunity for perpetrators of crimes. He described the campaign of calumny by African leaders describing the ICC as an imperialist tool which Western powers use to neutralize African leaders as a mistaken one, which should not be allowed to deprive the continent the benefits ICC offers. Dr. Ebwe Osuji, a presiding justice of the court, told the gathering that the campaign followed the ICC non-prohibition of immunity for heads of state in Article 27 of the Rome Statute. And in 2014, the AU leaders adopted a new provision in a bid to confer criminal jurisdiction to African court.
There is no truth whatsoever to that allegation. As an ICC judge, I can tell you that. Benefits of the ICC as a last bastion in the fight against impunity is extended to victims everywhere.
If we are going to fight impunity, if we are going to ensure that the masses, the people, remain the beneficiaries of justice.
The highly revealing lecture attracted reactions.
The generality of Africans need the International Criminal Court.
It's to improve life and standard of a living and to promote integrity in African countries. I am for it.
In Lagos, Viera Chimuba, NTA News.
And away from judicial matters, now the Chairman Council of Traditional Rulers in Lagos State and Oba of Lagos, Obarilwan Akiolu, has appealed to students, especially those in tertiary institutions, to desist from vandalism and remain law-abiding in their agitations and demands to school authorities and government. He made the appeal when a delegation of the Federal Polytechnic Rectors paid him a courtesy visit at his palace in Lagos. Doyin Dia has details.
The monarch Obarilwan Akiolu was speaking against the backdrop of the recent crisis in some tertiary institutions in Nigeria, said it is disturbing that students now resort to vandalizing infrastructure meant to help them and other members of the public. He therefore advised parents to nurture their wards and equip them with the needed orientation that would make them good ambassadors of their families and the country at large.
With the present leadership in this country now, things will change for better. So we should work hard. If you study well, find extra time to read your book, and anything you don't understand, go back to your lecturer. And by the time you do the exam, you come out in flying color.
Leader of the delegation, Dr. Matthew Akpata, thanked Obarilwan Akiolu for his kind reception and support for their member institutions in Lagos State.
We have been telling government to see what they can do to help us to provide all this equipment that are needed for the training of our students.
The support of our funding agencies like TED Fund, with that, we have been able to acquire equipment and try to bring in industry into the classroom.
The body appealed to state governments to support the federal government in its drive to reducing the massive unemployment through skill acquisition programs in technical colleges across the country. In Lagos, Doyin Dia, NTA News.
Traders and buyers at the popular Mile 12 market have appealed to the Lagos State Governor Akinwumi Ambode to reverse his plan to relocate the market to Imota community. They made their views known when NTA News visited the market over the state government proposed relocation. Rotimi Oluagbemi has details.
The plan to relocate Mile 12 market from its present site by the Lagos state government has been generating reactions from Lagosians. Some of the market leaders who spoke to NTA News decried the pronouncement, saying it has crippled their businesses. They appealed to the state government to adopt dialogue with the market stakeholders on how to beef up security and improve social infrastructure within and outside the market.
There should be a solid meeting between the marketers and the government.
We are talking of bringing food to the people's table.
We are employing people here. People are working here. People are training here. We are law-abiding women. We are law-abiding citizens. And everyone is okay in my 12.
Other people reacted to the relocation this way.
We no lie, make it remove this market too, because now this market they have everybody for this area.
As I old now, for where I go buy, minus I enter this my 12, buy, sell, see money.
I'm not even in support of relocating the market because it's helped the poor masses.
Like me now, I'm coming from VI to come and buy some things there. So from here to Mota is very, very far.
For those who are living in Lagos, this place is in the center.
I'm the governor of Lagos State, AP, Super and show the Mato market. Everybody go enter so far.
Meanwhile, the state government has raised the height of the road demarcation to prevent people from crossing the highway and be compelled to take the pedestrian bridge. This has greatly eased traffic congestion around the Mile 12 market. In Lagos, Rotimi Oluwagbemi, NTA News.
And those are the top stories from this end. It's back to Femi, who has more stories in Abuja. Femi.
Thank you. Abdullahi, River State Police Command has smashed an armed robbery gang suspected to be on their way for operation in Port Harcourt, killing one of the members in the process. The police briefed the media on Tuesday.
5 days ago, the owner of this Toyota Venza car was said to have reported that his vehicle was snatched at gunpoint, only for him to spot the car along Romola axis of Port Harcourt. He alerted the police and the special anti-robbery squad responded promptly, resulting in the death of one of the robbers and the recovery of the vehicle. State Police Commissioner Musa Kimo told newsmen that the hoodlums engaged the police on a gun battle, adding that one police vehicle was blown up in the process.
At the end of the day, one of the hoodlums was fatally wounded. One Toyota Venza vehicle was recovered. Toyota Camry vehicle was equally recovered.
The police, following a tip-off, also arrested a suspect and recovered two AK-47 rifles in Alo, adding that the command has recovered over 807 assorted ammunitions and dynamites from various armed groups in the state. The police commissioner, however, enjoined residents with useful information that could assist the police combat crime in the state to call the police for prompt action in Port Harcourt. Kingsley Amajiri, NTA News.
And in another development, the Nigerian Security and Civil Defense Corps is strategizing to further develop the capacity of private guards operators to function on intelligence gathering. This is part of collaborative efforts tackling security challenges facing the nation. Lydia Bassi reports.
Nigeria is encountering security challenges which requires the cooperation of all stakeholders. In addition to government security outfits, private guard operators are strategic partners to turn the tide. Group Captain Marcus TJ, retired, is the managing director of a private guard company with offices in Abuja and Kaduna. He is of the view that providing private security service is not just a business but service to fatherland.
There is going to be a new unit now of intelligent gathering. This intelligent gathering is going to work for us because areas like the Northeast, we know the problem there. And if you don't have people that can mingle with those people and tell you what and what is going on, there is no way security operatives can know.
The collaboration with the Nigerian Security and Civil Defense Corps to provide a secured environment unsafe for criminals, experts say, is a vehicle that will help cop security challenges in the country.
Some of them are retired SSS officers and so on that went to tap from the world of the experience on how to move the Corps forward. And that's why I said the recent addition to their mandates, whereby we have charter security officers, we intend to gather them, come together, so I will tap from their knowledge, especially those ones that have worked with military intelligence, the CID, the SSS.
The four-day workshop on managing best practice for a world-class private security business will provide the platform for stakeholders to repackage, re-engineer and strengthen private guards to effectively contribute to national security. In Abuja, Lydia Sampson, NTA News.
The National Lottery Regulation Commission says it will no longer be business as usual for illegal agents and sub-agents involved in lotteries, as the partnership with the Economic and Financial Crimes Commission, EFCC, will re-engineer enforcement and sanitize the process. This was made evident at a joint media briefing by both agencies in Abuja. Olajide Bello reports.
Collaboration and partnership for effective implementation of the National Lottery Act by the EFCC and the NLRC is against the background of a Memorandum of Understanding signed on March 17, 2015. Director General, National Lottery Regulatory Commission, Adolphus Joe Ekwe, says the commission adopted mapping of all lottery agents and sub-agents, as well as the activation of the newly developed SMS Transactions Monitoring and Archival Platform, STRAMAP, to ensure accountability and transparency.
Today's press briefing, therefore, is mainly to reaffirm to Nigerians, and especially our government, the commitment of these two agencies, the EFCC and the NLRC, to working together in sanitizing the lottery industry.
Chairman EFCC Ibrahim Magu says the commission is open to inter-agency synergy and cooperation geared towards transparency, accountability, growth and development of the country.
We have been told to migrate willingly.
I would sincerely apologize for the loss of sound on that report, and Nationwide, we continue now as we move to Benin Network Center, where Agatha is standing by to guide us on reports coming from that area. Take it away.
Hello Femi, thank you very much for joining us in Benin. Crown Prince of Benin Kingdom, the Edaike Nuselu Ehenede Erediawa, has expressed gratitude to President Muhammadu Buhari for giving him assurance of support for the Benin Kingdom. The Edaike, who was in Government House on a thank you visit to the state governor, also thanked Comrade Adams Oshomole for transforming Benin City. Agatha Egwariojo reports.
The Crown Prince thanked the President for receiving him in his private residence, where he informed him of events that will be taking place in the kingdom. He says the President's promise of support shows his respect for traditional institutions.
I'm about to make a major move, attempt a major milestone in my life. I don't think I should do such a thing, make such a move, without first informing Mr. President, and also for giving me assurances that he will support the ancient traditional institution.
Addressing Governor Somole as a Messiah of Edo State, the Edaike Nuselu expressed gratitude to the governor for introducing new concepts to the development of the state and laying a strong foundation for democratic process. Governor Somole says he is humbled by the visit and congratulated the Crown Prince on his installation as the Edaike Nuselu.
But Edo is still work in progress, Your Royal Highness, and we are determined to continue to work up to the last day. I will hand over the baton to the next person.
In Benin, Agatha Egwari, Ojo, NTA News.
Ojo, NTA News.
Practices and Other Related Offences Commission, ICPC, is forging a common front with the University of Benin Teaching Hospital to stamp out corruption in federal institutions in the state. To that effect, an anti-corruption and transparency monitoring unit of the hospital has been inaugurated. Udwakobong Achibong has details.
Their functions is to monitor and oversee compliance with certain categories of civil service rules, budget implementation, and enforce penalties for the violation of integrity codes. The Chief Medical Director of the University of Benin Teaching Hospital, Professor Michael Ibadin, promised to provide an enabling environment for members of the unit to report.
The persons that are serving there are not just ordinary persons, they have to be screened too, to know that their records are also clean.
Speaking on the theme of the sensitization program, Fumigating Corruption in the Health Sector, Dr. Bedung Amusung highlighted some of the corrupt practices identified in the sector and called for enforcement of relevant anti-corruption law and respect for ethics of medical profession. The Independent Corrupt Practices and Other Related Offences Commission in the state plans to take the corruption sensitization to other federal institutions. In Benin, Udwakobong Achibong, NTA News.
There has been a change of baton at the Navy Logistics Command, Ogara. The flag officer commanding the Logistics Command, Ogara, Rear Admiral Emmanuel Ofik, has been moved to the Naval Headquarters, Abuja, while Rear Admiral Silvanus Abba has taken over from him. Steve Lona Wunkulu witnessed the handover ceremony.
Doing flag officer commanding the Nigerian Navy Logistics Command, Ogara, Rear Admiral Emmanuel Ofik, thanked the officers and the ratings for their support and urged them to extend same to his successor, Rear Admiral Sylvanus Abba.
I must thank the Chief of the Naval Staff, Vice Admiral I.A. Kivas, who found me worthy to be appointed FOC Logistics Command.
Comrade, you have extended to the Adon FOC the same is what I seek of you, and by the grace of God, we will not disappoint those that send us here.
The outgoing FOC later inspected a guard of honor mounted by the officers and ratings of the command. Rear Admiral Emmanuel Ofik, who assumed duties at the Logistics Command Ogara in September last year, is now the Chief of Naval Assessment at the Navy Headquarters in Abuja. From the Naval Logistics Command Ogara, Steve Lonai, Nwakolo, NTA News.
And that's our package from Benin. Femi, it's back to you in Abuja for the rest of Nationwide News.
Thank you. And with Nigeria contributing less than 5% to HIV response, the network of people living with HIV/AIDS in Nigeria, NEPHON, has appealed to President Muhammadu Buhari not to assent to the budget because the provision for HIV was slashed. The group, in a press conference in Abuja, said the reduction of the HIV response budget from 8.9 billion naira to 8 billion cannot achieve any realistic targets. Aisha Obali reports.
The 2016 budget, which is yet to be signed by the president, has been generating controversies, though both the National Assembly and the general public have their opinion about the budget. This group, Network of People Living with HIV/AIDS, is one of the groups who feel the budget has not favored them. They noted that with about 3.5 million people living with the virus in the country, the 8 billion naira earmarked for HIV response in the 2016 budget, covering test kits, drugs and consumables for patients in only two states of Abia and Taraba, is not only a threat to the group, but the country could return to its HIV status of the early 80s.
I feel that there's still going to be an hope if the National Assembly and the executive mean business, or appropriation budgets, they can be able to, supplementary budgets, they can be able to consider increasing the budget for HIV response.
People that are married to spouses who are HIV negative have been able to maintain such marriages, having children and not infecting their partners, thanks to treatment, not condoms.
On the average, a patient needs 31,000 naira annually, and to provide life-saving therapy for Nigerians with HIV, a budget of close to 60 billion is required. Donors, who are 95% contributors to HIV funding in the country, are already pulling out. The implication of this, speakers say, is dangerous for the large number of persons with HIV who are largely unemployed. In Abuja, Aisha Uba Ali, NTA News.
And the federal government has been urged to review and create legal policy frameworks on inclusive education that will assuage the increasing number of out-of-school children with disabilities in Nigeria. This formed part of recommendations at the media launch on inclusive basic education for children with disabilities organized by the Joint National Association of Persons with Disabilities. Joseph Johnson reports.
Having observed that over 10.5 million children are out of school in Nigeria, and of course that's in line with UNESCO projections, the Joint National Association of Persons with Disabilities intends to change the tide with the declaration that all children, including those with disabilities, have a right to quality education.
Like many others in his situation, 34-year-old Yusuf Iyodu shares the typical challenges he experienced in the course of his educational pursuits.
I attended the university. The university is totally inaccessible. I had to go to lectures upstairs. Most times, the stress in climbing the stairs, you know, the hostel not accessible.
Disturbed by these and the alarming rate of out-of-school children with disabilities, these key players believe that the provision of accessible education for these vulnerable members of the society will not only be humane, but allow them to contribute their quota to nation-building.
So special school may not just be enough. We are saying that the regular schools that we have around, could we just take a step further to make this very inclusive, so that all children will have a space.
Speakers at the event described the launch as a renewed impetus that has the potential of uplifting the status of children with disabilities in the society. High point of the event was the official presentation of baseline survey report conducted in Akwa Ibom, Kwara States and the FCT. In Abuja, I'm Joseph Johnson, NTA News.
The Ahmadu Bello University Alumni Association has promised to harness its human resources in supporting the present administration. At a media briefing in Abuja, the president of the alumni, Dr. Hamed Tijani Mora, said the association has experts in all fields of human endeavor. Salu Abdullahi has the report.
The Alumni Association believes that as a body with enormous capacity, it has the responsibility to utilize its capital and intellectual strength to consolidate on the task of building Nigeria. President of the association, Dr. Ahmed Tijani Mora, says this effort is more needed, especially now that Nigeria is faced with the challenges of insecurity, religious intolerance, extremism, violence, and unemployment, among others.
We can't address every component of Nigeria's challenges that you have mentioned. For now and for this year, we are addressing ourselves only to the issue of ethno-religious crisis in the country. We, as an alumni association, are very much in tune with the mantra of change as being provided, as being spearheaded by President Muhammadu Buhari.
On the forthcoming lecture and award night, Dr. Mora said the event will feature lecture on managing the dynamics of ethno-religious politics for sustainable national integration and development in Nigeria, which is in line with the dreams of the founding fathers of ABU in Abuja. Salihu Abdullahi, NTA News.
And time now to pause for some messages. Nationwide continues shortly. Don't go away.
If you hear a bomb explosion or gunshots of an active shooter, that might be a terror attack. At such times, always remember three action words: run, hide, report. Don't try to run towards the terror scene to save the situation, because there might be a second bomb blast or another attack. Run far away and take cover. Make sure you are safe first. Yes, it is in our nature to sympathize over the hurt, but remember, only trained personnel can help in such situations. When in a secured environment, promptly call relevant authorities and help will come. For anonymous reporting, call 09630-3250-5 or 0813-2222-106. If you see something, say something. Nigeria, unite against terrorism. This message is brought to you by the Federal Ministry of Information and Culture.
This week on Airtel Touching Lives,
we visit a family that lost their father and two mothers, leaving them with nowhere to live. And we meet a family that is struggling to care for their children that suffer from heart conditions.
I don't want to lose my daughter. So mighty God, please help me. Oh God of Redeemer, God of Reable Redeemer, please come and help me and put my daughter in order.
Across Nigeria, there are more than 101 tourist and cultural destinations that can account for over 1 trillion naira in national revenues if properly harnessed. With profitable opportunities across its multiple value chain and to promote the Nigerian culture and tourism sector for optimum economic development, the Minister of Information and Culture, Alhaji Lai Mohammed, is inviting stakeholders to the 2016 National Summit on Culture and Tourism. Theme: Repositioning Culture and Tourism in a Diversified Economy. Special guest of honor, the President, Federal Republic of Nigeria, His Excellency, President Muhammadu Buhari, GCFR. Exhibition and Gala Night, 27 April 2016, 7 p.m. Conference opening and plenaries, 28th and 29th April 2016, 8 a.m. daily. Venue, Congress Hall, Transcorp Hilton, Abuja. Signed, Permanent Secretary, Ministry of Information and Culture.
We must remain steadfast
in our commitment to steer this country back to greatness.
He is one of the best brands that we have as a country, and we have to take advantage of that.
Look inwards and see how we'll be able to enhance our resources.
The problem of Nigeria is man-made. It's just a question of patience and cooperate with the government. Nigeria will go back to those better days.
The man who's leading us, he wouldn't talk much, but he does a lot.
We shall deliver security, jobs, and infrastructure. This is the right of all Nigerians. Our actions will speak for us.
Managing the finances of state governments and the question of insolvency. This is the focus on NTA Tuesday Live this week. Tuesday Live, informative, educative and incisive. Don't be told, join us.
Suicide bombers are not spirits. They are not ghosts. They are human beings like you and me. They live amongst us. They are your neighbors. They are your friends today, but terrorists tomorrow. So you must know your neighbor now. Security begins with you and me. Know your neighbor. Be vigilant. Be security conscious. Report suspicious persons, objects, and movements to the police and other security agencies. The security of our nation is a duty for you and me.
If you see something, say something.
You are still on to NTA Nationwide, and the chairman of National Health Commission of Nigeria, Alhaji Abdullahi Muhammad, says only first-timers intending pilgrims will be allowed to perform the 2016 Hajj operation. The chairman, who stated this at the first operational meeting with licensed tour operators, said all measures have been put in place to actualize the first-timer policy. Elias Wali Yakubu completes the report.
Reports have it that the Hajj operation has over the years been battling to ensure the actualization of first-timer policy. This is to enable the commission to discourage activities of some speculators who perform the Hajj operation every year for business at the detriment of first-timers who are willing to perform the operation. The chairman therefore said the 2016 Hajj operation is a no-go area for the old-timers.
And this we cannot have scarcity or non-availability of the slot or inadequacy of the slot, and then yet we allow people that have been going over and over to continue to do that at the detriment of those who have never been opportune to go and perform the Hajj.
The meeting also reviewed activities of licensed operators in 2015 operation, which was adjudged successful despite the twin tragedy, and plan ahead of successful 2016 Hajj operations. In Abuja, Ilyasu Aliakubu, NTA News.
In another development, the Kali Diocese of Jalingo has concluded its 17th General Assembly with a call on spiritual leaders to pay particular attention to the peculiar needs of individuals and families in order to address some of the challenges facing the society. Christia Yagwa Adaji reports.
The 7th edition of the General Assembly of the Catholic Diocese of Jalingo attracted the participation of the priests, catechists, reverend sisters, missionaries of the church, and a cross-section of members including traditional rulers. Most Reverend Charles Hamawa, the Catholic Bishop of Jalingo, who read the 7-point communique, said it has also become imperative for the church to continue to set the pace in spiritual, moral, and social matters in order to change the fortunes of the country. The communique also made recommendations on the current state of the nation, the status of internally displaced persons, and the responsible use of the social media.
We thank the government at both federal and state levels in their efforts to curb insurgency and attacks on local communities in Borno, Yobe, and Adamawa states. There is no doubt that these efforts are yielding fruits, but these situations remain desperate.
Earlier, during the session of the General Assembly of the Church, Reverend Father Anthony Nzinak, in a keynote address, spoke on some of the challenges hampering the growth of the mission, to include difficult terrain, inadequate mission workers, and lack of critical facilities. Goodwill messages from the stakeholders raised the need for all members to support the work of God whenever necessary. Highlights of the General Assembly sessions were presentations by various drama and dance groups of the mission. In Jalingo, Christy Ayagwa Adaji, NTA News.
Nigeria Interfaith Action Association also campaigns on malaria eradication. For details of this, I'm more or less joined Fatih in our Sokoto Network Center. Fatih, it's good to see you.
Joining us in Sokoto, a zonal training campaign on the need to eradicate malaria in Nigeria has been flagged off in Kebbi State by Nigeria Interfaith Action Association in collaboration with Health Communication Capacity Collaboration. Usman Abdullahi Shehu reports that the collaboration aimed at using Muslim and Christian leaders to fight malaria through their sermons.
Flagging up the campaign, the Emir of Gondu, Alhaji Muhammad Ilyasu Bashar, represented by Wazirin Gondu Alhaji Abdullahi Umar, described malaria as a devastating disease that requires serious attention.
It's unbelievable to hear that anything in this world can kill up to 300,000 Nigerians every year.
Earlier, the Executive Director, Nigerian Interfaith Action Association, Bishop Sunday Onaha, stressed the need to use religious leaders to disseminate the urgent need to fight malaria, as the disease has no religious barrier. He said government at all levels and donor agencies spend huge sum of money in the fight against malaria.
The mosquito bites an imam, and mosquito bites a Christian, and bites a pastor. And so mosquito knows how to do interfaith. And so we people of faith must know how to attack malaria.
In his address, the program manager at Kebbi State, Mr. Sami Olamiri, said the initiative is to empower religious leaders to be able to pass the message on the best way to fight malaria, considering their position in the society. The permanent secretary, Ministry of Health, represented by Alhaji Bello Bagudidigi, commended the organizers of the campaign and assures government support. Some stakeholders who spoke at the occasion commended the association, saying the program has come at a better time. The campaign has already kick-started in 9 local government areas in the state.
Brunei Kebbi, Usman Abdullahi Shehu, NTA News.
Worried over increase in the rate of road traffic crashes, especially in the northwestern region, Co-Marshal of the Federal Road Safety Corps has appealed to Nigerians to support the present administration's commitment towards reviving the transportation sector. The Co-Marshal, Boboye Oluyemi Oyeyemi, was speaking while addressing men and officers of Zamfara State Sector Command during an official visit.
The Co-Marshal of the Federal Road Safety Corps, Boboye Oyeyemi, who was on tour of various formations of the commission and other stakeholders, decried the high rate of road traffic crashes in the northwestern region and called for collaborative effort toward addressing the ugly trend. Addressing men and officers of the Zamfara State Sector Command, the chief executive noted that all hands must be on deck to ensure that road accidents are reduced to the barest minimum.
I made a stop over at Safe and I told them they need to do more. We reinforced the command there to provide more logistics to them. Operation is part of life savings, because a life you save today may be yours tomorrow.
The co-marshal, who identified overloading and overspeeding as the most dangerous causes of road crashes, stressed the need for regular campaign and public enlightenment, especially in motor parks and other public places. At the Zamfara State Government House, the co-marshal solicited the support of the government toward the establishment of a driving school and the provision of more logistics for the attainment of the commission's set objectives. The state deputy governor, Malam Ibrahim Wakala Muhammad, who stood in for the governor, said the state government is poised to support the Federal Road Safety Corps to enable it achieve its mandate.
Sokoto, Dalat Abdullahi, NTA News.
That's our contribution from Sokoto. It's back to you, Femi, for the continuation of Nationwide. Good afternoon.
Thank you, Fati. The Federal Capital Territory Administration says it will welcome useful suggestions from the National Institute of Policy and Strategic Studies in Kure Jos towards reducing poverty and unemployment in the nation's capital. The Federal Capital Territory Administration Permanent Secretary Babatope Ajakaye stated this during an interactive session with participants of the Senior Executive Course 38-2016 of the National Institute of Policy and Strategic Studies, one study tour of the FCT. Mitaire Ikwin reports.
Divided into six groups nationwide, participants of the Senior Executive Course 38-2016 of NIPS, Nigeria's foremost think tank institution, are studying the theme, Strengthening Institutional Mechanisms for Poverty Reduction and Inclusive Development Across the Country. The FCTA Permanent Secretary said the study is apt in the wake of daunting challenges of population explosion being experienced in the FCT.
Increase in poverty is facing us everywhere, even on the street of the federal capital. Because of the crisis in the southern part of this country, there's an influx of people from everywhere. Abuja seems to be one of the places they have decided to come and hide. And we have all manner of people that have to be fed, that have to be looked after. I'm sure from your study, you'll be able to arrive at resolutions that will help the government.
Submissions on the subject matter were also received from the Abuja Municipal Area Council and the Sapeyi of Garki Chiefdom.
If we are able to have the local government autonomy in Nigeria, I think we'll be able to tax.
Some centers will be created whereby the young ones, the girls, the boys, the youth will be trained.
From Itari, we move to our Enugu Network Center, where State Governor William Sobiano inaugurates three water schemes, and just as the Deputy Senate President also promises more infrastructural development. Let's join Chair Gono.
Good afternoon, Femi, and welcome to Enugu. The Deputy Senate President, Ike Ekweremadu, has promised to attract infrastructural development to the people of Ezeago and other local government areas in Enugu West Senatorial Zone. Amaka Owo reports that Senator Ekweremadu stated this during a solidarity visit to him by the people of Ezeago. The people of Ezeago local government of Enugu State embarked on a solidarity visit to the Deputy President of the Senate to show their appreciation for projects he attracted to the area and pledge their continued support to him. They were led by prominent sons and daughters from Ezeago who took turns to speak on the positive impact of Senator Ike Ekweremadu's representation while urging him to assist the area in the reconstruction of several roads.
He has also promised us that once budget is released, that road will be given a maximum attention.
The member representing the Ezeago Federal Constituency, Mr. Venice Amadi Ogwerinam, who spoke on the Enugu Onitsha Expressway, said that budgetary allocations have been made to rehabilitate the road.
I'm privileged to know that Enugu Onitsha Road, part of the fund for continuity, have been provided in this budget.
Responding, Senator Ike Ekweremadu called on Nigerians to uphold the unity of the country. He promised to partner with the people of the area and fulfill his campaign promises by embarking on road construction and provision of water to various parts of Ezeago, among other developmental projects. Senator Ike Ekweremadu also appealed to those in governance to serve the people in the interest of democracy. In Enugu, Amaka Owo, NT News. Three communities in Anambra State have benefited from the small town water schemes of the state government. The water schemes executed under the 2013 and 2014 Millennium Development Goals of the federal government have been inaugurated by the state governor, Chief Willie Obiano. Benson Osadebe tells us more.
Allah. Umoze in Urumba South Local Government and Ewariam Anambra East Local Government Area. Inaugurating the schemes at Ihala and Umoze, Governor Obiano promised that his administration will continue to provide potable water to people of the state and charge benefiting communities to protect the facilities against vandalization. Addressing indigents and students of Odunigbojukwu University, where the Ewariam project is cited, Governor Obiano identified provision of potable water as key vision of his administration. He explained that the state government resolve to provide conducive learning environment to schools informed citing the water scheme there.
I was told that the students had challenges with water. And today, you must be having water in your hostel regularly. I want you to get this so. This university has already been known for this. I don't want people to incite you to do anything that will distract what you are there for, which is academic excellence.
Governor William Obiano of Enugu State. And to sports now, let's join Kenny Imagbudike.
250 amateur golfers have registered for the 2016 Captain's Cup scheduled to tee off Saturday at the IBB International Golf and Country Club Abuja. Briefing journalists on Tuesday, Chairman Competition Organizing Committee Samuel Anyamele said the 18-hole stroke play game is to mark the tenure of Hamida Bo as the club's captain. Captain of Achimota Golf Club, Accra, Ghana, Frank Adu, is also expected to grace the occasion.
I'm going to see good game and then comradeship. And to crown it all, a very good atmosphere for Nigeria, and then people come in.
The Nigeria Cricket Federation has released the names of final 14 players that will wear the country's jersey at next month's ICC World Cricket League Division 5, scheduled for 19th of May in Jersey Island, United Kingdom. Among the names are Captain Kunle Adebola, Onwuzilike Chimezie, Okwudili Emmanuel and Emmanuel Bejide. While the local campaign for the selected players ends on the 2nd of May, another 2 weeks in May have been set aside for a pre-tournament tour in London. Novak Djokovic and Serena Williams completed a clean sweep for tennis as they won the Leroux Sportsman and Sportswoman of the Year awards. Djokovic beat Barcelona footballer Lionel Messi, sprinter Usain Bolt and Formula One champion Lewis Hamilton, among others, for the top men's award. Williams also dumped Jamaican sprinter Shelly-Ann Fraser-Pryce for the women's award. Both athletes picked up the top prizes for the third time. With Sports Update, Kenen Imabodike, NTA News.
And as it on NTA Nationwide, do join us for more reports in our subsequent bulletins. Good afternoon.